And number three, Alexandre Pantoja gets the, I put unanimous decision. Sorry, folks, wasn't a unanimous decision. This was a submission victory against Brandon Royval. And listen, man, it was nice, man. This was second round. And this is what made it so great to me is that it was unexpected in the sense that I thought that Pantoja was getting tired, man. It looked like Royval was coming on. Looked like he was doing all of the things he needed to do to make the fight his fight. But Pantoja, there's one thing about the man. He sticks to the basics. He sticks to the fundamentals, and fundamentals win championships, man. Shout out to Tim Duncan, the big fundamental. Tell me what you thought overall on this matchup, AJ, on this fight. Like, did you – I know you said earlier that Brandon Royval, you know, he probably maybe was a little tired, things of that nature, man, but I thought he looked great for coming off of a shoulder injury. What do you think?
Bro, he was looking amazing. Like, he was sprawling, he was rolling. Pantoja didn't look like he was able to get a grasp, and Pantoja came out hot and heavy in the first, bro. Like, he literally opened up the fight with some fire in him, and he started to look like he was wavering a little bit towards the end. You know, the end of round one, I really started to think Brandon Royval was kind of getting the best of him. But man, yeah, you like you said, Pantoja stuck to the fundamentals. He got the body lock. He got the arm in under the chin. You could even tell. First off, I didn't expect any of that at all. I thought Brandon Royval was going to keep with the sprawls, keep rolling. I thought he was looking good. But you could tell Brandon Royval was a little upset in himself that he tapped, man. He tapped out, and then I'm like, fuck, I really just did that. Like, it was a hard one to watch, especially for a Royval fan like me. But, man, Pantoja put in some absolute work. Like I said, I didn't expect this at all. I expected Brandon Royval. He looked like he was doing better, man. I expected him to come back in the better in the second round, keep the sprawls rolling, keep the transitions going. But all credit to Pantoja, man. He stuck to his game plan and he stayed true. And like you said, that's what wins championships, man. He put up a good show and a hell of a submission on a dude who's known for his submissions too.
Yeah, that is the most impressive part about it, man, is when you're known for the submissions, when you're known for the rolling and the scrambling and to submit the man, it's just like, man, this is how Brandon Royval made his mark in the UFC. You submit Tim Elliott, you come in, you submit Kai Kara France, you're an LFA champ, all that good stuff. But Pantoja's been in the game for a really long time, you know what I'm saying? And that's why it's important for me to assess this and be like, listen, man, we got to give the man some credit. I feel like he just still is under-respected, even with this win and the gentlest, nicest call-out you've seen in your life, where he says, hey, Moreno, you know I really like you, man. You know it's all good, but a 30-26, you know, I got you good. I made you a little bit better, you know what I'm saying? And Moreno's sitting there like... It's funny, man. It's funny and it's comical and all that. But once they get into the cage, you know, they turn it on, both of them. You know what I'm saying? And I just have it right here in front of me. I wanted to look it up. So when we're looking at the significant strikes, man, Pantoja outstruck Royval by a very slight edge, 22-17. And then when we're looking at takedowns, 3 takedowns from Pantoja, 1 by Brandon Royval. Is that expected to you? Did you expect Pantoja to initiate the takedown sequences as much as he did?
No, not at all, my man. I expected, like I said, I expected Brandon Royval to be the one looking for the takedowns, looking for that stuff. And I was honestly expecting Pantoja to be put on his back foot. Wasn't that way at all, man. It was a very unexpected fight, at least coming from my side. Did you expect him to be the one doing the takedowns and all that stuff?
Well, you remember, as I was saying on the preview show, man, that his control, like I said, they have different ways about they go about the BJJ, right? For Royval, he has better scrambles. For Pantoja, I thought he had better just control. And that's what I wanted to comment on. So, like, to answer your question, I thought he would try to control. I didn't think he would really sit there and try to be like, all right, we're going to make this a grappling jiu-jitsu match or whatever. But let me just ask you this, man, because sometimes it's overrated, but we'll tell you one person who benefited from it a lot recently, Vince Pichel, when we'll talk about that in a second, but he's been hitting the weight room. And some, he's like a 40-year-old man. He says this is the first time in his career he started actually really lifting weights. Do you think that played into a factor there? I just felt like Royval didn't have just the physicality, the strength to be like, get off me. You know, sometimes you got to use your technical capabilities, but sometimes you could just get off me. You know what I'm saying? Like, tell me what you think. Do you think that he needs to start hitting the weight room or what?
Oh, 100%, Derek, because when both people know the technique, it cancels each other out. Sure, you know, you might be able to be Mr. Technician and be able to get that down, but when the other guy knows exactly what you're doing and he feels your body go to this and he goes, oh, no, I know what you're doing. I'm just going to flip it this way. I'm going to roll the opposite. I'm going to do, you know, all this stuff that I'm supposed to do because it's technique. You know, it's basically like being written down in a book. That's when the strength comes into play. And you saw it in Brandon Royval. He did put, you know, he once the body lock was on him, he rolled to the correct side. But Pantoja's like, nah, bro, like, I ain't letting this happen. Like, I know exactly what you're trying to do. I'm just going to choke you out now. Yeah, I definitely think Brandon Royval, he needs to hit the weight room, or at least he needs another advantage and not just to rely strictly on technique, because at this high of a level, everybody knows the technique and everybody knows exactly what to do. So he needs that extra little bit of advantage going forward, man. What do you think?
No, I'm absolutely with you. And I do think that Pantoja's Brazilian jiu-jitsu is like pound for pound up there in the flyweight division. Like, I really think the dude is a monster, man. But my last question to you comes down to this, man. We know Pantoja, clearly he's probably going to get a title shot after here. That's what Dana White said. And we need to talk about, we'll talk about it more in the matchmaking and whatnot, but Askar Askarov is probably the person who really deserves the title shot. However, he missed weight in his last fight. And I think that you need to penalize fighters for missing weight. You can't miss weight, win a fight, and then get a title shot after. I feel like that's just not right. Pantoja made weight. He got the job done. He already has two wins over Moreno. He probably should be next in line for that championship, even though I do think it's a little unfair to Figueiredo. But nonetheless, my question to you is this. We know Pantoja's stock is going up. Do you think Royval, with such a valiant effort that he put on, that his stock is even decreasing at all? Should he stay at number six? Is it going to get dropped down a little bit? What do you think about that?
Nah, I think he stays at number six. I mean, it definitely did drop, at least in my mind, a little bit, you know, especially going the game plan we all thought he had. We thought he had the scrambles, and yeah, the scrambles were amazing in round one, but then they absolutely disappeared in round two. Mm-hmm. So in my mind, the stock did get hit a little bit. I wouldn't drop him anywhere past, you know, the top 10, even if he does lose a little bit. I think he stays there, though. But Pantoja, I think this one goes more towards the credit to Pantoja than the discredit to Brandon Royval. And it really put Pantoja on that map for how real deal of a fighter this dude is, and how dirty and how, like you said, like a technician this man is, man. All more credit to Pantoja than the takeaway from Brandon Royval on my side.
Yeah, you know what? That actually makes a lot of sense. And I will say this. Look at the four opponents that Brandon Royval has had to face in his UFC, the start of his UFC career. You start off with Tim Elliott, submit him. Kai Kara France, submit him. Fight the champion now, Brandon Moreno, right? Before he was the champion. You dislocate your shoulder throwing a hammer fist. You didn't really lose that fight. Technically, you did, but because it's the fight game, but you didn't really lose it. And then you fight Alexandre Pantoja. Like, that is a killer's row of fighters. So, like, to disrespect the man and to say, oh, you suck, X, Y, and Z, yada, 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 it's not true. It's just literally not true. It's, you know, it's the people, like, you know, when they do the meme or the people sitting back in their chair with the remote and all the food around, and they'd be like, bro, I would have just, like, you know what I mean? I would have hit a Gramby roll and I would have spinning heel kicked him and what, you know what I'm saying? Cats like that, man. You know, listen, we all can be keyboard warriors from time to time or whatnot, man. But listen, you got to give all respect to these dudes who are getting out there and putting it all on the line in the cage, man. But big win for Alexandre Pantoja. We'll talk matchmaking.